Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of People Make a Difference. I'm your host, Danny Brassell, and it is my pleasure that this week we're going to profile Heifer International. Heifer International has one simple goal: to end hunger and poverty in communities throughout the world and to take care of the earth. And it is my distinct honor and pleasure this week to have as my guest Jeane July Stern. Jeane, thank you so much for agreeing to come on the show this week. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. It's going to be a pleasure talking about Heifer.
Great. Well, tell us all about Heifer. I want to know more about it.
Well, you mentioned it earlier. Their whole goal is to end poverty and hunger and to care for the earth. It is a humanitarian and nonprofit organization. They've been around since 1944. Mm-hmm. And not too many people have heard about it because, unlike a lot of the large organizations that do charity work around the world, they don't do a ton of advertising. You know, it's more like word of mouth. Of course, they do have a website, but most people don't know about Heifer.
And I want to get everybody that website right now. We're going to put that on the screen. The website is heifer.org, and it's, you know, the first time I'd actually ever heard of the organization was I was in Little Rock, Arkansas a couple of years ago speaking, and there was just Heifer plastered all over the convention center.
Yes.
And somebody started talking to me about it, and from that moment on, I fell in love with the organization. So what exactly does Heifer do?
Well, because of their goal to end hunger and poverty, they believe that, well, it's the saying that if you give a man a fish, he eats for a day, but if you teach a man to fish, he can eat for a lifetime. So instead of just supplying the needs for that day, Heifer contributes to families all over the world, or actually in about 54 countries, livestock, seedlings, trees, anything that you can think of that can help a family to become self-sustaining, because most families and people as a whole really want to know how to take care of themselves instead of just being taken care of all the time. So they give needy families that are going through really hard times livestock. They go through serious education and training how to take care of the livestock, and after a year, once they've had the livestock and they've learned how to create income from, say, a goat, you know, from the milk, creating cheese, they mate that goat with another goat from another village, and they do what is called passing on the gift. And so once that offspring is born, they give that gift to another needy family in the village, and it just goes on and on and on. So it's just giving back, giving back, giving back.
And that was one of the most amazing things that I discovered just researching it. I was like, oh my gosh, there's people that, there was a story of a woman in Rwanda whose husband and son had been murdered during the genocide.
Yes.
And you know, she was down on her luck. This is in the mid-1990s. Mm-hmm. And they gave her, I believe, it was either a goat or a calf. Mm-hmm. And once she got back on her feet, she then, of course, gave her firstborn calf to another family. But then she took it even further, and she gave money to help another family purchase livestock, and then she adopted four orphans. And I mean, this is a pretty profound impact that this is having on communities. How did you get involved with it? I mean, it's something that a lot of people really don't know about, and I mean, I have a lot of involvement in different community organizations.
Yes.
This has got to be one of the most amazing things I've ever heard of.
Well, I never heard of it until I met my husband, or actually before we got married. He was saying, oh yeah, I give money to this organization, you know, once a month kind of, and I said, well, what is this? He goes, Heifer. And I, of course, not knowing what that is, he explained the whole principle of Heifer and what they do and their mission statement. And I thought, this is pretty cool. Mm-hmm. Because the creator of the whole idea was Dan West, back in 1944, he belonged to Church of the Brethren. Mm-hmm. And so my husband's family was Church of the Brethren, so they knew about it. Mm-hmm. And so he, his uncles, all did something for Heifer, you know, in donating. And but to also to say about Dan West, he actually sent the first shipment of cattle in 1944 to Puerto Rico.
Oh.
And that was how that started. And it just became this whole thing, you know, of just, okay, we're sending it over to Europe. Even during the war, they were sending cattle and livestock to Eastern Europe and all different places that were going through devastating times.
That's amazing, Jeane. Now, one of the things that amazes me on this show is I always get to profile all these really cool organizations that are making a difference, but it's really the people that make a difference.
Yes.
And so, you know, you met your husband, you got involved, but tell us more about your whole background. I'm fascinated by that.
My background is, I'm a Texas girl, but I've been here in Los Angeles for almost 15 years now. And I am in the entertainment business as an actress, a dancer, voice actress, and vocalist, singer. And so I'm here actually just living my life, pursuing my dreams as a singer, actress, dancer. And my whole goal actually is to continue in the entertainment business, but I want to give back as well.
And well, you're definitely doing that.
Yes. And you know, and Heifer is definitely the major love of my life. Mm-hmm. And but there are also, you know, other avenues where I'm giving back to children in the community as well.
So. Well, and one of the things I had noticed, Jeane, is that you do this wonderful podcast of meditative exercises and things like that. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about that.
Well, the meditation podcast is something that was my husband's idea. He's a musician. And I would like to say, you know, that we are pretty spiritual-minded people. Mm-hmm. And the podcast is a way for people to download meditation for themselves. We've done, I would say, about 7 of them. And we have a website, which is meditationpodcast.com.
Oh.
And people
maybe we can
just
get that on the screen.
Maybe so. I hope so.
Get that for you.
And so people can download.
Actually, say it one more time
okay,
so they can,
sure.
they can get it on.
Sure. Meditationpodcast.com.
Oh, that's nice and easy to remember.
Yes. And so we just started working together in our home studio and producing about 30 minutes, 30 minutes to 45 minutes of meditation. We lead people into it, and it's not a cure for anything, but it's a way for people to kind of, you know, work out, just learning how to relax. There are certain issues that we've dealt with as far as, you know, forgiveness and how to go through and actually just kind of retraining your subconscious to let go and release certain things in your life. So
it's interesting how I meet people that are involved like this, and they always seem to take it a step further, and it becomes part of all-encompassing. One of the things that I had seen in Heifer International was that they were talking about the 12 cornerstones of the organization, and this is what separates Heifer to me. Is like you said at the beginning, is that you can give a man a fish, or you can teach him how to do it, and it seems like this isn't. When I had first encountered Heifer, I thought, oh, that's great, they give livestock to needy families, but it is much, much more than that. I actually wrote down the 12 cornerstones. I don't know if you know them. But the first one was, as you talked about, passing on the gift.
Yes.
And, you know, I gave one example, but I was hoping maybe you could give us some more examples of that passing on the gift, because this to me is extraordinary. This is something where it's really showing people that receive, that all of us, while we receive, we also have so much to give, even if we're in the poorest country in the world. And I had read about that woman in Rwanda, but what have you seen, what turns you on about this organization in terms of the passing on the gift?
Just the fact that it's, you know, no man's an island. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're all out here working together. We need each other. So say in a village, if one person is doing well in the village, then just think you can help out your neighbors now. And then it goes on and on and on. And in a lot of the villages in the other countries, it's a big ceremony. I mean, it's a huge ceremony with dancing and food and the whole idea of, okay, I'm bringing you baby chicks and I want to give that to you. And it's just like this celebration. How wonderful is that? That I'm going to help you out of your situation by giving back to you. And it's a real trickle-down theory in the fact that these people who are receiving the gift are able to help out their families to improve their children's education. Mm-hmm. The children come back, a lot of them come back and try to help out and also join the organizations there that are partners with Heifer to improve their communities.
And what a great way of building people's self-esteem, their self-worth,
yes,
when they realize that they actually have something that they can contribute. It seems like that goes into the second cornerstone, which is accountability.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything more involved with the accountability besides passing it on to others?
Well, basically, you know, that, again, with accountability, that they're taking control of their situation. And it's something that, you know, because with the cornerstones, since there are 12, you know, you have the accountability, the spiritual growth,
mm-hmm,
everything, all of it's just encompassing. So it's the community being responsible,
mm-hmm,
for, you know, themselves. And also the fact that with the cornerstones, such as in Nepal, where Heifer has organizations to help women build their self-esteem, and to create income for themselves, there's a sense of just pride,
mm-hmm,
the sense of pride that they're getting.
I like that you touched upon that, Jeane, because I was,
yeah,
just going to get into that, because that was something I was starting to notice in all the success stories, and
yes,
there's numerous ones, but one of the big ones was they were profiling a lot of women,
yes,
and there was one story in particular that moved me. It was about a woman in, I believe it was the Dominican Republic,
mm-hmm,
and she has an alcoholic, she was only 37 years old, she had an alcoholic abusive husband, she,
yes,
had 7 kids, and she started taking the classes with Heifer,
mm-hmm,
and her instructors almost removed her because they thought she was really inattentive, and it turned out she was having ulcers or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But then she wound up graduating, and she's become like their go-to person now,
oh,
in the,
yeah,
Dominican Republic.
Yes.
But I thought that was just amazing, how this woman now has been self-empowered, and she said at the end, she said, "Now if my husband, if he wants to leave me, it doesn't matter because I can take care of myself."
Exactly.
That was powerful.
Yes, and that's the story of a lot of the women,
mm-hmm,
who are involved with Heifer. There's stories that women who are from communities where, of course, women aren't educated, and they're treated more as servants when they live with the husband's families, and so there's no real income coming in,
mm-hmm,
and they want to do something to help and to build their self-esteem as well as provide education for their children. So they get involved with Heifer, and everything just turns around for them, and they become just this, almost like a pillar, you know, of the community,
mm-hmm,
because they see here's a woman who's creating income, and, you know, she's standing up straight, and, you know, she's not having to walk with her head down. One example was also in Nepal, where the women's self-esteem was so low that they couldn't really lift up their heads and even say namaste, you know, just the light in you. It's like it couldn't even come out of their mouths. And when they became involved with Heifer, they created actually a women's group to you know, where Heifer was helping them to build up their ability to create income,
mm-hmm,
become more self-sufficient, and now they're just this powerhouse group where they're donating money for children's education. They're giving back into the community and building roads, you know, building sanitation was really bad, so,
mm-hmm,
they're building a whole new sanitation structure there just from what they're doing and just because Heifer became involved.
Wow.
Yeah.
And I those are themes I see throughout the organization, self-sufficiency.
Yes.
It's probably the one website I've ever gone to where I've never seen the word hope used as much as I saw it on this website. It's really hope and... you know, I know you're an educator. You have a background in education and,
mm-hmm,
in teaching dance. Is it just dancing, or what's your background in education?
Mostly in dance, yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I want to take a dance class.
Oh, yeah.
But that's something I was interested in, was the whole education process,
yes,
of the organization. Can you tell us a little bit about more how they educate the people as well as just providing the livestock and the hope?
Well, they basically learn how to take care of the livestock. The whole husbandry aspect of it, how to create, you know, the food for the livestock, but, you know, how to actually set up the structure where it's beneficial for the animals, and then how to create the income from that animal, you know, whether it be pigs or chickens, even bees. There are areas in Europe where, you know, we send bees. And it really all depends on the climate and the region of the world, what's most conducive for the animal. So
they're not just sending a horse somewhere. They're making sure to educate themselves on the background of where they're at.
Absolutely. Right? So they learn a lot about that. So they're being educated in that way. Women who, especially in the women's program or in areas where there hasn't been any education, you know, they're learning basic skills, you know, about counting money, multiplication, these things that are vital for them to know how to take care of themselves and how to, you know, protect their assets. So that, along with Heifer partnering with the organizations in that community, you know, just creates this whole empowerment thing where, you know, they're just farms of people, or excuse me, are people who created these farms, and they're working together. The interesting thing about the animals too, because I said that, you know, depends on the region. There's a lot of crossbreeding as well.
Wow.
So when Heifer sets up their animal stations in different areas of Los Angeles, I have seen zebras crossed with ponies, and, you know, and it's like a totally different type of, you know, or zebras crossed with a mule, and just creating these whole new animals, you know. But it works for the areas where they go to. I mean, it's interesting. So
you're learning everything. Well, and then I had read that you actually attended a Heifer University. What was that all about?
Oh, yeah, in near Santa Cruz.
Okay.
And it was a weekend educational retreat, where we learned all about Heifer, their structure, what the goal is, and as far as our role as leaders, or I'm part of the Leadership Development Council, what we can do to help improve Heifer, as far as, you know, fundraising, donations, and things of that nature. But it was really especially learning about the how each of the organizations are set up, you know, in different parts of the world, and, you know, and how it actually works. Because Heifer doesn't just walk in somewhere in Zimbabwe and say, okay, we want to go ahead and help, we're going to give you this, we're going to give you that. It doesn't work that way. No one from Heifer just comes in and tries to change things, you know, just infiltrate. We go to areas that where there is an organization or some type of group that is set up and has said, you know, we need help.
And so people have to ask for assistance.
Well, it's also asking, but it's asking, but it's also saying, you know, we're here if you need us. And so it's kind of a you know, mutual thing where they do. So it's never just come in and just take over. It's like, okay, because the group is in that area, say, of Zimbabwe, in a village, and they know how the village is structured, they know the social situation, the economic situation, we say, okay, so this is how we possibly can help you. And so we help that group to take care of their own people in that way. So it's not like we just swoop in and, you know, and boom, put a flag up and say, this is Heifer. But, you know, but there are headquarters that are set up, you know, in different parts of the world. And I also have to say, you know, we're talking about Africa and Southeast Asia and China, but Heifer is also here in the United States.
Really?
Yes.
I didn't even read that. Where are we in the United
States? In 27 states, actually.
Wow.
Massachusetts, New Mexico, Arizona. We also help with the indigenous tribes here on the reservations to help them set up certain things and to help create income, you know, farming, livestock. So it's not just we go all the way overseas.
Wow.
We're here in the U.S.
Well, that's really important, I think, because a lot of people, I always hear this, you know, because I have a an open heart for a lot of these organizations, because I thought it was interesting reading about Heifer that you have like a short-term disaster like the earthquakes in China or Haiti, and they're there, but Heifer is not about the short-term solutions. They're about long-term sustainability.
Exactly.
And when you say that, Jeane, about them also being here in America, now I'm you've really piqued my interest, because I know a lot of our viewers are interested. How do they get involved in working with Heifer? What did you do to get involved with Heifer?
Actually, through my husband who introduced me, we found out about certain dinners that were going on, and we had a chance to meet with the president of the Southwest region here, which is Pamela Stone. And so we just said, you know what, we want to help out. Mm-hmm. We want to do what we can. You know, we donated money. We bought gifts in the name of a friend or a family friend, you know, which is actually, by the way, a great idea for Christmas.
Great.
The person who has everything, donate a cow, $25 to buy chickens or something, and say this is in the name of, you know, my Uncle Fred or whatever.
You know? Well, and I'm glad you said that, Jeane, too, because it seems like anybody can participate in Heifer.
Yes.
You and I both have a passion for school-age children.
Yeah.
And that intrigued me also, is that for as little as $20, you could buy a flock of geese.
Absolutely.
So what can those teachers do to inspire their kids to do something like this? What do they have to do?
Well, you know, on the website, there are ideas and there are school programs and things that Heifer actually, we send out people to who can come and talk to the kids or train the teachers or give them booklets and kits and things, so they'll know, okay, this is what Heifer is about. But, you know, all they have to do is contact Heifer and say, you know, we want to do something for our children to be more aware of the organization and how they can give back to the communities around the world. So, once again, there's the website. It can direct you to the links, mm-hmm. you know, to who to contact,
okay.
You know, to find out what they can do. Like I said, since Heifer isn't really big on huge mm-hmm. advertising and a lot of people don't know about it, you know, we just kind of
Well,
say,
we got to
you know,
spread the word on
now
this.
You
we'll get this on YouTube and start spreading the word. So let's get that website back on screen for everybody. It's, again, heifer.org. It's pretty easy to find. Heifer.org. And you don't have to just give money to participate in the organization. Yeah. One of the things I love that you just said is that they'll send somebody out to teach the kids, because these 12 cornerstones, Jeane, I think are things that are amazing. I mean, they have things like gender and family focus, full participation, improving the environment. And I, before we end our time together, that was one other thing that intrigued me, because we've talked a lot about bringing all that self-confidence to people and building up an economy. But there was a term called agroecology that they had about helping the environment, and I just wanted you to talk a little bit about that before our time's up together.
Sure. The agroecology, pretty much like, you know, going green, and to using the resources from the agriculture of the animals, and say, one example I'll give you. What we learned in Heifer University is a group of people that they were raising pigs, and they were using the refuse, you know, the methane from the pigs to heat up the water, you know, to help create heat and water and all these things to, you know, for the families in their homes, you know. So it's like, you know, the whole ecology is like just recycling and learning how to use it over and over again to help the community. So that's one example. And also, you know, planting of trees in certain areas helps to stop the erosion also in different areas of the country, you know, at different areas of the world where there's, you know, because after a while, you know, the soil gets depleted. And so the trees need to be planted in order to create, you know, more of a solid base and, you know, the nutrients and everything. It's just, everything just starts to return back to the earth. So that's the whole thing, is just turning it back to the earth.
I think it's amazing.
Yeah.
Before we end, I want to make sure I got about a one-minute video courtesy of the heifer.org where Alton Brown from the Food Network tells us a little bit more about heifer, and then we'll wind up together. So why don't we just look at this really quick clip from heifer.org.
Hi, I'm Alton Brown, and I used to have a goat. Where did my goat go? Well, it went to a family who really needed it, just like the heifer cow I used to have and the water buffalo, which was really too big for my place anyway. Now, why send livestock? Why not say tractors? Because giving an animal is like giving someone a small business. All that wool, the milk, the eggs turn into income for medicine, school, clothing, a better home, a sustainable livelihood. It even produces fertilizer for crops. And of course, it makes more livestock, because you know, animals make baby animals. That's what they do. The next thing you know, the family that you gave your gift to is passing on the gift of the animal's offspring to another family who does the same thing, and so on, until pretty soon you have helped to lift an entire community out of poverty, all with your gift to Heifer International. That is a recipe for lasting change.
Thanks to Alton Brown from the Food Network for that wonderful little promo. I'm here again with Jeane July Stern from Heifer International, and we're just concluding here. What's your vision of the whole future of this whole organization, and what do you want to accomplish, Jeane?
That, you know, I find that a lot of the wars, especially the genocides that take place in different parts of the world, a lot of it is economic based, mm-hmm. and the haves and the have-nots. And we want to be able, I see in the future that if Heifer can go into such as the areas of this Rwanda that went through that horrible genocide, and Bosnia and all these places, and say, you know, there's a way that everybody can have. You know, we want to be able to give that to you. So that would be the idea and the place to be in the world, where everyone is able to just be self-sustaining, and no one has to depend on just that bag of beans or that bag of rice that comes in, you know, every few weeks. It's like, okay, we're going to show you how to do this.
I think it's a tremendous gift, Jeane. I think it is amazing. I think it's just an amazing organization, and it's something that everybody from the elderly to the youngest school child can participate. And again, the website is heifer.org. I have had Jeane July Stern as my guest. Thank you so much
Thank
for coming
you.
On the show.
Thank you.
You make a difference.
Thank
and
you.
Folks, all of you can make a difference in your community. Thank you so much for joining us, and we will see you next time on People Make a Difference.